Welcome to this 10th podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to early trauma in addiction. We will talk about the link between childhood trauma and addictions, the many ways trauma can manifest in the individual, how traumatic events sensitize the nervous system, and how exposure to trauma results in the altering of memory. To begin with, many individuals diagnosed with addictions of all forms have a past that includes traumatic experiences. This is particularly true of people suffering from process addictions. They exhibit responses that are common in other trauma survivors, such as dissociating from painful experiences and blocking out feelings related to the trauma, finding pleasure in the face of extreme danger or violence, dysfunctional attachments in the presence of danger and exploitation, unconsciously seeking situations that recreate the traumatic experience, and a deep sense of shame rooted in the traumatic experience. Dr. Patrick Carnes is an expert on sex addiction and the executive director of the Gentle Path program in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Here he describes why many addictions are linked to some sort of trauma in childhood.
We're going to talk about early trauma. The fact is, we found that emotional trauma, sexual trauma, and physical trauma was very much part of this whole scenario. And you might say, well, how does that happen? Well, first of all, we had 81% of both men and women talking about sexual abuse of some type or another. The real commonality in all of it is you have to understand is fear is the chief chemist of the brain. Fear alters things. In a book that we require all of our CSATs to read, the Certified Sex Addiction Therapist, it's by Lou Cozzolino, called Neuroscience and Psychotherapy. He makes the case in there that every addict, every addiction has a trauma component. Every addiction has a trauma component. And as I started to add up the number of addicts, we found that the more trauma you had as a kid, the more addictions you had as an adult.
As Dr. Carnes mentions, trauma and fear have intense and lasting effects on the chemistry of our brains. Exposure to trauma results in the altering of memory through damaging our limbic system. This damage can have lasting effects on behavior later in life. The Adverse Childhood Experiences study showed that exposure to traumatic events before the age of 18 increased the likelihood of physical and mental health problems, including addiction, decades later. Dr. Matthew Hill from the University of Calgary explains how early life adversity increases the physiological response to stress and therefore affects how the brain responds to stress in the future. This also leads to changes in brain structure that can affect the brain's higher order functioning as we grow older.
All of these studies have demonstrated that early life stress increases rates of depression in adulthood. Now, interestingly, independently, both the ACE and Dunedin studies seem to estimate that the early life stress accounts for approximately one-third of depression in adults. So that's a pretty big number, considering how many cases of depression there are that are out there. The nature of the early life stress is critical for the emergence of depression especially. Abuse is the most significantly associated with depression, while low socioeconomic status is more associated with metabolic diseases per se than something like depression. So the data do reinforce the concept that these early life stresses can increase the propensity to develop both mental and physical diseases. And what's really interesting, I find, is that the disease states that emerge following these early life stress essentially mirror the effects we see of chronic stress and allostatic load in adults. So this kind of suggests that maybe what's going on is that early life stress is basically changing the set point at which stress is perceived, or the way that the body physiologically responds to stress, and essentially puts these individuals almost in a steady state level of increased stress. So they're starting to experience what we would expect from allostatic load. So, and there is evidence which indicates that this early life adversity can lead, can increase the physiological response to stress. There have also been studies that have shown that individuals who experienced childhood emotional maltreatment exhibit smaller volumes of the hippocampus and the prefrontal cortex. Now, we've seen this in individuals, as I said, in the study Bruce had done with medical students currently undergoing stress, but when they were removed from the stress and they had a recovery period, it bounced back. This is just individuals who experienced stress early in life, and presumably they are not currently undergoing any stress, and yet they still exhibit this shrunken volume of these brain structures involved in stress perception and higher order functioning. So this kind of supports the idea that you've got the state of allostatic load that's developed from this early life stress, and that the loss of these structures here is possibly contributing to the maintenance of this state. So these studies demonstrate that there's a sensitization of the stress axis at multiple levels, both within the brain, the way we process stress, and also in the periphery, in the way that our body responds to stress. There seems to be a sensitization of all these processes following childhood abuse, maltreatment, or adversity early in life.
Trauma is a powerful experience that stays with us all of our lives. For many people, it's never gone. It's always there. This is because early life trauma can leave lasting effects on our abilities to understand and regulate our emotions. This leads to what is known as emotional over- and under-modulation. Dr. Ruth Lanius, a professor of psychiatry at the University of Western Ontario, explains.
So broadly, I think what occurs in post-traumatic stress disorder, that we can both have an emotional under- and over-modulation, and I'll explain those things in detail. So when you're talking about emotion under-modulation, I think we often refer to re-experiencing hyperarousal events, intense fear, and anger states, all emotional states that are very common in post-traumatic stress disorder. However, we can also have emotional over-modulation, and I think those emotional states have often been neglected both in research as well as clinical practice. And the emotional over-modulation really occurs in an attempt to restrict unwanted emotional experiences. So when emotional experiences get too intense, people need to find a way of disconnecting themselves from those experiences, as we talked about earlier, such as depersonalization or derealization. And such states of emotional overmodulation include states of dissociation, numbing, as well as analgesia. So often people with chronic early life trauma will actually report that when they cut themselves, they don't have pain. So they have a numbing response of their emotions.
Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he talks about his own battle with emotional overmodulation, where he tried to hide his addiction by excelling at school and work.
With this growing sense of my outsides and insides didn't match, I had this sense of shame. If you knew who I really was, you would not be saying those nice things about me. So it meant that I had this growing cognitive dissonance, this awful feeling of shame that just kept driving me. And by driving me, it made me achieve more and more and more.
So academically you achieved?
I won the undergraduate gold medal in honors physiology before medical school. In medical school, I was the class valedictorian. And I don't think that's atypical. I think that, so if you're looking for us, you'll often find us near the top until very, very late. If you're waiting until you see us disintegrate, to deteriorate with obvious psychosocial problems or work-related problems, it's late, late, late. There's been a lot of damage, perhaps central nervous system damage and psychosocial damage, to the point that coming back is very difficult. The mortality rate goes way up.
Trauma can have differing effects on different individuals and population groups. For example, interpersonal violence is a common traumatic experience for girls and women, and can be a significant contributing factor to the development of addiction in women. This is because the traumatic event leads to a sensitized nervous system and painful emotional states that can develop into self-destructive and destructive actions. Dr. Stephanie Covington is the co-founder of the Center for Gender and Justice in La Jolla, California. Here she describes the process of trauma and how addiction treatment needs to be responsive to and appropriate for the gender of the person in treatment.
So what does women-centered treatment look like? What does each woman need to have? I think she has to have the ability, knowledge, she has an addiction. She has to be able to create a connection with other women. She needs to have an accurate diagnosis and appropriate medication where necessary. She needs to understand the impact of alcohol and other drugs on the female body, since most of the drug education we give women is about what happens to men's bodies. But we don't tell them that part. She needs to understand the connection between trauma and addiction and have a wide selection of clean and safe coping skills, a recovery plan, and certainly we have to consider her housing, her food. Are her basic needs taken care of? The emerging paradigm in the States is this: that we have to have values-based services, gender-responsive, trauma-informed, culturally relevant, and recovery-oriented for mental health and substance abuse. And into this values-based services, you then bring evidence-based practice. But evidence-based practice doesn't necessarily provide good services. There have to be some underlying fundamentals. So what makes a difference? Women-only groups, integrating substance abuse and trauma, a safe, nurturing environment, the length of treatment matters, being able to complete treatment, the continuity of care, and most importantly, continuity of relationship. Is there a way that a woman can come into a system and meet someone who becomes her care provider and have some continuity over time?
So how do we go about treating a person who has adopted self-destructive and destructive behaviors due to exposure to early traumatic experiences? In essence, services need to be designed based on an understanding of the physiological and emotional effects that trauma has on the individual. These could be described as trauma-informed services. In many cases, intervention services that work to increase the emotional awareness of the individual are the most effective. Dr. Covington describes trauma-informed services and gives an example of how a dentist transformed their practice in a trauma-informed manner.
And the language we're beginning to use is trauma-informed services. The belief is that if you work with people, a doctor, a nurse, a school teacher, an addiction counselor, a correctional officer, you need to understand trauma in order to adjust what you do so the person can benefit from the service you're trying to provide. Let me tell you about a dentist I worked with, a trauma-informed dentist. She didn't think it was outside her scope of practice to become trauma-informed. She realized that her dental office had many triggers for people who have abuse histories. Think about it. You go to the dentist's office, you're put in a chair, and you're tipped back. Someone's leaning over you. They're taking an x-ray, they put a heavy plate on your chest. They're working with the mouth. For many children with sexual abuse, the mouth was. So there are many triggers in the dental office. What does she do now? When people come to her dental office, she says to them, in case you ever feel any anxiety or any discomfort in the dental chair, let us know. You can get up and walk around. Who knew? TV in the ceiling. You can watch television. You have headphones for music. They have you do breathing before they put the metal plate on. I did a tutorial with her staff, and now they are trauma-informed. And it's a universal precaution. Everybody is treated the same way. Just like we used to, used to be with HIV and AIDS, your file would be flagged because you were positive. Today we have universal precautions. We are all treated as though we're HIV positive. Everybody in her dental practice is treated as though they are a trauma survivor. And all it has done is provided better care and a sense of care for everyone. And it is not outside her scope of practice. So if the dentist can do this, certainly substance abuse providers could do this.
So here is a summary of the key points in this podcast. Many individuals diagnosed with addictions have a past that includes traumatic experiences. Early life trauma can leave lasting effects on our abilities to understand and regulate our emotions via emotional over- and under-modulation. A traumatic event leads to a sensitized nervous system and painful emotional states that can develop into self-destructive and destructive actions. Exposure to trauma results in the altering of memory by damaging our limbic system. Interventions that focus on increasing the emotional awareness of victims of trauma have demonstrated positive outcomes. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMeds competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. First, in what instances do you feel it would be appropriate or advisable to determine if a patient has a history of trauma? 2. How would your approach to your patient change if you became aware of a significant history of trauma? 3. In what ways do you think practicing physicians could make their services more sensitive to the needs of their patients with trauma histories? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on early trauma in addiction. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlin Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.